She's gonna make us dance all the way down the Jericho Road. Huh? That's not a bad way to enter. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Doris. Thank you. Gonna miss that. Maybe. Take that however you want. Deacon Wooder's gonna come and he's gonna minister to us in small song this morning, and we've been praying his socks off too that he's feeling better. I have to tell him though, in certain areas, misery loves company. Lord bless you, brother.
Good morning. I was thinking as Pastor's been talking about different people in here, what a small world it is. You've heard me say that the written hours when I moved out to Atwater were my Sunday school teachers, and I've kind of traveled around following them my whole life, not really knowing I was doing it. And when he was talking about Bell over there, when I was moved out to Atwater, about a year after we lived out there, I was about 13 years old, my parents bought me a Honda 70. And I used to travel up and down the road in front of Bell's house, probably doing 50 miles an hour without a helmet. And I think about it now, she probably was thinking, that crazy kid, he better slow down and he better get a helmet on. And hopefully she was praying for me. And because she did, I didn't get in any accidents there. And I'm here today. And just how everybody's kind of tied together. And you find that out over life. Ron Bargerstock taught Sunday school for us over at Liberty. And I used to love to listen to his Sunday school lessons, and I had his grandkids when I was a school teacher at Crestwood, and it's just amazing how God ties things together, isn't it?
Amen.
I'm going to sing a song today that I've never done before. This is a song that Jonathan White sings, and he actually made the track for me so I could give it a try. When I heard him sing it, right after I heard him sing it, I couldn't stop singing. It's one of those ones that just... you keep singing it, and once you hear it, you want to sing it. It makes you feel good. I'm sure many of you know it. If you know it, you can sing along with me. Excuse me where I fail in the song, but I'm going to give it my best try here. So.
I worship your holy name. name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your great unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. I will worship your holy name. Worship your holy name.
I'm going to ask you to turn in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 1 with me this morning. Ephesians chapter 1. And obviously, the very first aim in the name of the Lord here this morning, from my perspective, is as I bring to you the message from God's Word, is to please God Almighty. And in that objective, if I'm pleasing God Almighty, I know that I'm doing His will this morning. I ask that you share that this morning with me, that you be found in His will and be found pleasing to Him. You know, I get a picture of God, that throne room, if you will, and the prayers that are lifted up by the saints of this house, and Him just going, just the sweet-smelling savor. You know, that's what happens to our prayers, if they make it beyond the ceiling, that is. There's a lot of things that hinder our prayers. If you're not being the husband to your wife that you should be, God says even your prayers will be hindered. If we're not lifting those prayers with the right fuel, then that rocket's just going to fall. It has to be lifted in the name of Jesus Christ. He's not a generic God. He gave us His Son, Jesus Christ. It's by Christ we make it to the throne of grace. Amen. It's by Christ we have a free gift of salvation. It's by Christ. It's by Christ. It's by Christ. I'm always thankful to the faithful that help support missions in a financial way, and bring your tithes and offerings into the storehouse on the first day of the week of today, the Lord's Day. All of those things are great things for the Lord's business, but none of which will get us to the throne of grace. None of which that will get us to the throne in heaven. It's only that precious blood of Jesus Christ that will get us there. And so I want to make sure that that is understood. My first and foremost today, my wish for everybody here is that should there be a big bang in this room, there'll be nobody left sitting here. This place will be totally empty. Totally empty. We'll leave it for the Episcopalians. Ephesians, that went over. They can shoot back at me next week. Ephesians chapter 1, if you will, please. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 2, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen, church.
Amen.
Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. I want you to know today as you sit here that if you have truly come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior in your life, you have been given spiritual blessings all over more than any place else. You have them. You have them. And I want you to know that you have them. And as I tell you this morning through the Word of God, what you have, I shared with the Sunday school class this morning, it's kind of like, you know, it's that nugget that you're digging through your drawers looking for something at home, and you come upon this little envelope with some money in it, and you go, oh, I've totally forgot I stashed this here. And it's months have gone by, and it's just like a great, great surprise. Anybody ever do that before? Yeah, some of you probably do it a lot. it's a great thing, and then you're all excited as, wow, what, now you know, I don't remember why I did this, but now what am I going to use it for? That's the feeling that I want you to capture this morning through the Spirit of God. I want you to capture that once you come to realize what you have, and you all of a sudden open that drawer this morning in the Spirit, I want you to understand what you have, and I want you to see how excited you can get on how you're going to use it. Amen?
Amen.
That was a weak amen. Amen?
Amen.
All right, amen. And on that note, I want to tell you that setting on the altar are Bibles. These are free Bibles. If you need a Bible before you leave today, you avail yourself to that. It costs you nothing. If you know somebody that you want to share the Word of God with, you come up here and get this before you leave and take it with you and handle it. So if it's during the message today, if God places somebody on your heart to come up and get a copy of His Word to take to them, it's right here, it's free. Just grab it on the way out the door. You don't even need to say thanks. Thank Him, because He's the one who provided it. I didn't. All right. With that said, blessed be the Lord and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who had blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. If you look at verse 7 with me, in whom we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of His grace. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
We see that. Look at verse 15 this morning. Verse 15, we also see that, wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, ceased not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, Lord, as we've read your word, I want to say, as the overseer of this flock of which you've appointed me, I am thankful. I am thankful to see the testimony of their faith here today simply by their mere presence. They've had the faith to come and worship you. They've come to faith to hear your word. They've come to faith. They've answered the call today, Lord. And Father, may they answer the many calls, if should you tarry, that lie before them from you. Father, thank you for their faithfulness. Thank you for your grace to us this hour. In Jesus' name, amen. And as we look at verse 15 again, we see that, wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints. Your faith. I thank God for your faith. The church family here at the New Testament Baptist Church, I thank God for your faith, because I get to see a picture of something that He is supplying. And I get to see that through you. I get to see not your mental state of your belief. Anybody can say, I believe. Anybody can say, I'm a Christian. But to show the fruits of that is a picture of faith. Amen. It's a picture of faith. And I get to see that. And I'm so thankful for that this morning. I'm not talking about a belief in certain doctrines. I'm talking about faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Faith in the Holy Spirit, in which is indwelt in you, and faith in the Holy Spirit, which has sealed you until the day He decides to come and take you away. Whether that be at the rapture, which would be the only time. Verse 16, we see that we see in verse 16, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. I cannot tell you, folks, how much I pray for you. And I don't say that to sell you on anything. I just want you to know that the burner is turned on high, and I pray for you, which means I'm lifting you to God. I'm not praying for my benefit. I'm praying to lift you to God, that a mighty work is done through you out of this house. That's what I pray for, because you're now a vessel. When you've come to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I don't care how young you are, I don't care how old you are, I don't care how middle-aged you are, and in case you're one of those folks who like to fool yourself, let me set you straight. It's given unto man 70. That's 70 by my mathematical calculations. I smart. 70. After that, you're in a bonus. And there's travail of years, right? Amen. Things start, ow. So if you're not 70 yet, don't be complaining. But you know, you can stop fooling yourself, because if you're 1 minute over 35 years old, you're middle-aged. That was free. Piece of a pastoral encouragement there. Verse 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. That's how I pray. I pray because God taught me how to do that. He taught me what to ask for in your faith. I thank him for your faith, but what I pray for is that he does just this. He gives you, as we see in verse 17, that he gives you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. He gives you that. He gives you that in verse 17, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. Why? Because you're a vessel now. You're a tool of his, located in here in this New Testament church, and which he has called, and he is the head of, and we are the body of. And he wants to equip you, and he wants you to be a vessel, a tool, a light. And how do you fuel that light? How do we fuel that vessel? How do we fuel this individual body that makes up the church right here that you can see, touch, taste, smell? How do you do that? How do you do that? Well, you get his wisdom and his knowledge. Very important. But I want to tell you, he has blessed us with this. If you just look back at verse number, verse number 3, blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who had blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places with Christ. He's given you the blessings, folks. There's not a one of us that have trusted Jesus Christ that he hasn't blessed us with this Spirit. But I want you to find it. I want you to dig through the drawer, the spiritual drawer this morning, and I want you to find what you may have misplaced it. Or maybe, you know, you've never picked it up to use it. But you have it. You have it, I trust, because God tells us that you have it. I want you to take a look. You mark your spot there in Ephesians chapter 2, but I'm going to take you on a trip back to the Old Testament, and I want you to go back to Isaiah chapter 11 with me. Isaiah chapter 11 in the Old Testament. Wonderful, perfect word of God. No scripture is for private interpretation. You can't take it and bend it and shape it any way you want. And in the true scripture of God, one always bears out the other. It makes a full, perfect circle this morning. Are you with me there in Isaiah chapter 11? And I direct your attention this morning, church, to verse number 2. And I want you to go ahead with me. And I'm going to follow along slowly, because this is a really, really, really complex teaching. So we're going to do it like this. And the Spirit of the Lord, can you say one? Okay, some of you couldn't say one. And the Spirit of the Lord is? Okay. Shall rest upon him. And the Spirit of wisdom, 2. And the Spirit of understanding, 3. And the Spirit of counsel, 4. And the Spirit of might, 5. And the Spirit of knowledge, 6. And the Spirit of the fear of the Lord. 7. You got all 7 right there when you got saved. They're right there. When you trusted Jesus Christ, this is the seven spirits that lies within Him. And when He lies within you, you possess all seven of those spirits. Now I'm going to take you to the last book in the Bible, which would be Revelation. And I want you to go to chapter 4 with me in the book of Revelation. I'll give you a moment to get there. That last book can be hard to find. Revelation chapter 4, please. And we know that something really great in Revelation chapter 4 takes place. Very, very great in Revelation chapter 4. Why, it could take place before I say the final amen today. And that would be the rapture of the saints. That would be Jesus Christ appearing in the clouds of glory at the sound of the trumpet, sound of the archangel, and then we're gone. And that, in the twinkling of an eye, the scripture tells us, which scientists and medical science says is like 18 hundredths of a second. Could you imagine? I don't even know that we would hear the sound that was left over from the boom. Where to go? And I don't want anybody to be left here should that happen in the middle of this message. And you don't want to be left here. Because you enter into a terrible, terrible time, and you are guaranteed to spend the rest of eternity in hell if you miss that one. And you don't want to do that. You don't, and I don't want you to do that, and that's my prayer today. So as we say that, as we show you this, as we see these seven spirits that embodies our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that when I come to trust Jesus Christ as my Savior, I receive Him. Okay, I don't receive Him through some wine. I don't receive Him through some act of communion. I remember Him that way. I don't receive Him that way. I receive Him through the Spirit of God. As He told Nicodemus in John chapter 3, that you cannot see the kingdom of God except you be born again. A man is born of the water. And when I came out of my mama's belly, I was born of the water, but then you got to be born of the Spirit, which is the Holy Spirit of God. Amen. You have to be born like that. Holy Spirit, don't come swooping down, landing on you, jumping on your back. You know, don't do any of that. When you come to truly, truly trust this gift of salvation that God the Father gave us through the Son sends you the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit indwells you for the rest of your natural life. And He seals you, Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30, until the day of redemption, which means you can't leak out. You can't lose it. Nobody can pluck you out of His hands. Nobody can steal you out of there. He's got you all taken care of because it's not yours in the first place. It's something that He controls. Amen? Amen? That's a great thing to know. No matter how much of a rascal you and I are, if we've got Jesus Christ in us, we're sealed till the day of redemption, and nobody can snatch us out of that. However, there's going to be a time when there's this great harpizo, the snatching away of the saints, that we call rapture. The word rapture doesn't appear in the Bible, but the Greek word harpizo does. And it means to take us away. And that's what He's going to do to us. But before He does, He's given us all of these spiritual blessings, all seven of them. And it's my prayer, just as the Apostle Paul was praying, that we dig those up and find them and we use them. And that he makes those bold to us. Now look at this. We see in Revelation chapter 4, as we're looking there, we see in Revelation chapter 4 and verse 1, after this I looked and behold a door was opened in heaven. When that door gets opened up, folks, something's going to happen. And I can tell you that after Revelation chapter 4 and verse 1, there is no other mention of the church. It's gone. It's gone. You'll find the church in the chapters before that, but as of Revelation chapter 4, verse 1, the church is gone. It is no more on the face of this earth. But when you have the Holy Spirit indwell in you as a result of your salvation through Jesus Christ, I want you to understand something. When the church is gone, something's taken off this earth. Besides just us, there's something else that's removed. The Holy Spirit of God is removed. Now watch this. Watch this. Jesus came, and he was embodied in those seven spirits. Isaiah chapter 11, verse 2. He was embodied with those. Ephesians chapter 1. We get those because we have Christ dwelling within us. And we are a part of his body in this church. So with that said, when he takes those off this earth, he who now letteth, by the way, in Thessalonians we see, but when he removes the Holy Spirit from this earth, you know what? Jesus Christ could care less about this shell that the Holy Spirit's living in. This happens to embody his spirit. This shell happens to embody his Holy Spirit. So if he decides 5 minutes from now, to his Holy Spirit, if you're like helium, if you're a balloon with helium and they call it a helium home, your balloon's going too, okay? And that's what we find out. That's what we find out. But after that happens, check this out. Look at verse number five in Revelation chapter 4. And out of the throne, bless you, out of the throne proceedeth lightnings and thunderings and voices. And there were 7 lamps. How many, church?
7 lamps
of fire burning. Where are they at? They're before the throne of God now, which are the 7 spirits of God. They're gone off the earth now because we're gone too. And they're going to be in, and there they are once again, right there before the throne of God, those 7 spirits. Because we're not going to need that anymore, by the way. We're not going to need that because we got him right there. But right now we need it. It's a very important aspect of our life right now. We're a vessel. We're a tool. We're a light to be fueled by his spirit. What's in it for us? If you go back to Ephesians chapter 2 with me, Ephesians chapter 2 again, I ask you to hold that spot. So if you were obedient, saints, to the pastor, Ephesians chapter 2, what's in this for you? If you look at verses 18 and 19, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, the eyes of your understanding, not the person sitting next to you, but this is something personal. It's directed right at you. The eyes of your understanding are being enlightened by this. That's what's in it for you. In verse 18, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling. I'm Ephesians chapter 1 is where I took you back to. I said 2, but my bad. If you were paying attention, you should have known. So chapter 1 and verse 18, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. Being enlightened. You know, in 2 Corinthians 4:4, we know what God's word says, what Paul said to the church of Corinth. He said, for the god of this world, that small g, the devil, Satan, the great deceiver, the small g, the god of this world, hath blinded the minds of those who are without the light of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ. See, we're not like that. We have spiritual vision. He's enlightened our eyes, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is that hope of his calling and the riches of his glory. He's given you spiritual eyesight to know the riches of his glory. If you know the riches of his glory, you all should have big smiles on your face right now. See, I should walk down there and see, so I got the riches of God's glory. I got those riches. I've got them all over. It's a great, great thing he's given us. I want you to find that today as you look through that spiritual drawer. He says, and what is the riches of the glory of the inheritance of his saints? Y'all got an inheritance that know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You've inherited something. You know what you've inherited? Do you realize that the transfiguration of Jesus Christ before he went to the cross of Calvary, he went there and he did some pretty cool stuff, didn't he? A couple of his disciples got to see what? They got to see Moses and they got to see Elijah. They called him by name. How'd they do that? 1,500 years of life in between those disciples and Moses and Elijah, and they said, oh Lord, should we make a little tent here, a little tabernacle for Moses and Elijah? You see, when they were in the midst of Jesus Christ during that transfiguration, they got to see. And they knew. You know, the scripture tells us that you'll be known. You'll be known. And you'll know as you are known. You see, when we've inherited what Jesus Christ has, we will know everybody. The moment we enter into heaven, we'll know everybody. And everybody will know us. Isn't that something? It's not because of us, it's because of the inheritance that we have. You know, if I die today, my wife inherits everything that I have. A couple cars, yeah. But we inherit all that, and we can, that's what we glory about today. We glory that if you stop breathing in one of these pews, you're going to be present with the Lord. You're going to be present with the Lord. That's something to glory in. So as we see in verse 19, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power? To usward who believe, we have exceeding greatness in his power because we believe according to the working of his mighty power. So what's in it for us? Many, many things here. Look at verse 20. God's power, I want you to know something. It's on the sign out front. God's power to us is the same power that raised our Savior from the tomb. God's power that you have within you as I speak to you is the exact same power that raised Jesus Christ on the third day from the tomb. That's what you have in you. Man, if you can't say a hearty amen to that, you're dead. Amen? I mean, that's good stuff. That's great stuff. But you just have to realize it. Those are the prayers that I have for the saints that are here today, that we see and glory in these things. We realize what we have in our Savior, Jesus Christ. He has not bankrupted us. He has blessed us with his Spirit, what the Scripture tells us. Turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15 as we begin to close out. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And you got to know, you got to know, if you've trusted Christ, he has saved you from death. From death. From death. Eternity is a long, long time. And true belief that he wants to enlighten our spiritual eyes with is, child, I have saved you from death. You say, well, does that mean this body's not going to pass away? No, that doesn't mean this body's not going to pass away. What it does mean is that when this body passes away, it's going to be great. It's not over. And you're not going to be screaming that some dirty beggar touches the tip of your tongue with a drop of cool water for all of eternity. That's great. That's good news. That's great news. You don't have to look in the mirror and imagine what you're going to be like screaming in the torments of hell when you go home or when you get up in the morning. That's right. You don't have to do that. You can be assured, guaranteed, slam dunked into heaven. Chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians. Join me here in chapter 15 and verse 50. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. For in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. Change. This is talking to the brethren. This is talking to the born-again believers. And we shall be changed. For this incorruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. I like victory. Victory is always a good thing. Especially when I'm on the side of it. Victory. But then we go on to see in verse 55. O death, where is thy sting? You know, I think a lot of times when I preach a funeral service or an interment at the graveside, and I read that passage of Scripture, a lot of people look at me like a deer in a headlight. They have no idea what that means because they don't have that hope. They don't have that hope. But the Scripture says, oh, death, where is thy sting? Where is it? I don't have it because the Lord took it away. Oh, grave, where is thy victory? Let me tell you something. My brothers and sisters in Christ that I know have trusted him, and their bodies are laying out in the grave, whether it be at the Maplewood or these jerks that are in prison for ripping people off. It don't matter what hole in the ground they're in, wherever they're at. When Jesus appears in the clouds of glory, they're not there no more. They're not there no more. Guaranteed not there. The grave has no victory over any of you that have trusted Christ as your Savior. That grave is helpless. It's no threat at all. The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law, but thanks be to God which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? In the last verse, therefore, the Word of God tells us, therefore, after I've told you all these things, God says through His Word, listen to them and let them sink in. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast. Be steadfast. Unmovable. And not a part-time abounder, but always abounding in the work of the Lord. You say, preacher, how am I supposed to always be abounding in the work of the Lord? You get yourself into God's church. You cannot abound in the work of the Lord by your thoughts, your ideas, Satan's manifestation to your mind. You cannot do it. It is impossible. God has said that. It is His will, His way. He's given that. You see it right here. We see it right here. It is in the local church house that missionaries are supported. It is in the local church house that the ministry goes out, the gospel goes out, the preaching goes out, the teaching goes out, the Bibles go out. It is here that it goes out. With one head, and it's not Pastor Bob Burgess, it's Jesus Christ. He's the head. That's the one way it's done. And that's the only way it's done. And when man and religious denominations make up their own ways, they have a head that has usurped the true head, and they are no longer got a candlestick in place where it's supposed to be, and they're not a true church. Oh, they might be a church by Satan's standards and by the world's standards, and oh, that's great. But it ain't going to get them to heaven. And Jesus says, if you just study the seven churches in Revelation, every one of them, He tells them, I'll take your candlestick out of there. I'll take it away. I'll take it away. We have to be a part of His body, which means He has to be the head. We learned that in Sunday school. Amen? Verse 58, therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. You say, preacher, I want to do this. I want to work for the Lord. Then you find yourself in God's house in a good Bible teaching, preaching. I like to think this is one, but if it's not, you find one that is. But not by your standards, but by God's standards. And you don't know God's standards until you know this. Which is why we give these away. Because we want the world to know God's standards. Okay? I don't want people following a false Christ. I don't want anybody going out of here thinking that there's any other way to get to heaven other than the real Jesus Christ. And there are false Christs. They're all false. There's a lot of people that says to Jesus, Lord, Lord, I professed you among men. Lord, Lord, I cast out devils in your name. Lord, Lord. And he said, hold on. Depart from me, you doer of iniquity, for I never knew you. He's not impressed by that. He just gave us his formula today. That's the only one that he honors. He doesn't honor what I think. He honors what he thinks. He honors my obedience to him. Oh, it's not legalism. It's called being obedient to our God. Whatever your need is, as Brother Adolph comes, we're going to have an invitation song. Remember my first prayer this morning that there would be nobody that would be left here should the rapture take place because they know Christ. So the first thing I'm going to ask, I want to challenge you, that if you've never trusted Jesus Christ, I mean the real Jesus Christ, I mean trusted him in this way, my life is nothing but dung. There's nothing I can do to save myself. I can be in church every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Sunday school, every Wednesday night, but without Jesus Christ, I have no victory. You see, we have to know that we put nothing between us and him. And when we ask him to forgive us, and we trust the real Jesus. I mean, Paul says, I fear lest ye follow another Jesus or preach another Jesus. They're out there in the form of religion. And if you don't understand and you don't know, then you're wolf bait. That's what the Bible tells us. So you have a decision to make for the Lord today. Do you want Jesus Christ as your Savior? Can you die to yourself and allow him to have you? That's the decision today. Perhaps you're here today and you say, you know, I've been saved, I'm baptized, and I want to become a member of this local church where I can serve the Lord with all these blessings he's abounding. Whatever the need may be, you come. Stand with me as we sing.